what to do with the markets in turmoil. Our next guest is not a fan of saying, stay the course. Axel Merk of Merk Investments joins us today on Kitco News. Axel, good to have you back on the show.
Hi, great to be with you.
So what do you make of the volatility we've been seeing in the market since the start of the year? What's behind the global sell-off, and why do you say we shouldn't say, stay the course?
Oh, I love these markets, and the reason I say don't stay the course is because you should have stayed the course during the good times, meaning you should have stayed to your plan to rebalance, to take chips off the table when times are good. The time to prepare for the good times is, for the bad times is when things are good. And most people don't do that and haven't done that. I know that because I talk to advisors and retail investors alike. And so they're overexposed to risky assets such as equities. And sure, when volatility picks up, they start screaming, but they should have been concerned when everything went up in the backdrop of volatility. And what's behind this drawdown is that the Fed's attempt to try to engineer an exit. The Fed was fostering complacency, keeping down volatility, and so asset prices were rising on the backdrop of low volatility. When that happens, people feel complacent, they don't know the risk they're taking on, and so suddenly they realize this world is risky, these markets are risky, and they say they didn't sign up for that. I believe this adjustment process will take a very long time to take place, not least because these low interest rates have fostered all kinds of malinvestments, such as in fracking. And those zombie frackers, as I may call them, are going to stick around for some time because at zero interest rates, they can pay their rates until their debt has to be rolled over. And so this adjustment process is going to take a while, and we haven't seen the rest of the turmoil in the markets.
And Axel, on the note of the Fed, I know you've said that, you know, the market simply is not trusting central banks right now.
Well, last December, you might recall, Mario Draghi was promising to overdeliver, and then he didn't. And ever since then, central bankers, when they've tried to appease the market, it hasn't quite worked. Earlier this year, we've had a couple of Fed folks come out and still talk about four rate hikes this year. The market isn't buying it. And most recently, Draghi again doubled down and said he is ready with his bazooka. In fact, his bazooka might just be a water pistol compared to what he's going to unleash next. The market is taking it with a grain of salt. And the reason is that the Fed had this lid on the pressure cooker that has come off, and putting that lid back on is going to be all but impossible. And so central banks, yes, they'll double down at some point if these deflationary forces that we've seen unleashed of late are going to play out more, but they're going to have a very, very difficult time getting the upper hand of things.
So Axel, what do you make of it when people say this market is similar to 2008? Is it?
I think it's more like 2000. In 2008, we had a deleveraging take place as volatility picked up. We have that now as well, but we don't have quite the same systemic issues because financial institutions are more or less in the game. In fact, in 2008, financial institutions were liquidity providers to the extent possible. Now we've regulated that away. We've pushed the risk into entities the Fed might not be able to rescue. But if I just look at the markets, I don't see at this stage anyway the systemic fallout on the debt side. We'll see some of that. But what I see more is markets that just are going to grind lower and lower and lower, because every time we have a rally, people are going to realize that, yes, there are more interest now in capital preservation, whereas until last summer, they were interested in buying the dips. So I think it's more that mood shift. In 2008, we really had a collapse of the financial system that was at risk. I don't see that at this stage. Who knows whether that will happen, but I don't see that right now.
All right, Axel, let's wrap with your thoughts on gold. You've been bullish gold. You like gold. What's your take on the metal and how it's standing right now?
Well, gold has been doing exactly what it should be doing. Gold has been a wonderful diversifier historically. It has a near zero correlation to equities in the long run. And so early this year, as equities plunged, gold has held up very well. So it's been doing a great job in that. Now, if we do have these relief rallies in the equity markets, odds are that other commodities might outperform gold because it held up so well. But again, it's a diversifier. And as I believe that this correction in the equity market is far from over, I think that's going to do very well. And then in the long run, I like gold because I don't think we can have positive real interest rates. That's ultimately the competitor to gold that doesn't pay any interest. And as such, I'm not too concerned. What I'm waiting for really is for the Fed to acknowledge that it can't go and pursue this hiking cycle anymore. I think then gold is going to rise in earnest again.
Axel, thanks so much for your thoughts today.
My pleasure.
And thanks for watching this edition of Kitco's Gold Report. We'll see you next week.